And council, if it's all right, it's a couple minutes to the, hour. So we welcome you to our first CCW after our holiday season. We welcome administration, Tyler, our student, and the press, and also Curtis McCarthy and Jill taking minutes. So welcome to our council meeting. We haven't got an opening prayer here, so I'm going to ask if Mayor Kronen, would you offer the opening prayer?
Oh, you surprised us. Dear Father in heaven, we come before thee at this time. Grateful to be here, gathered as council for the town of Cardston, and be desirous to look at the issues that are pressing and before us, that we might find the wisdom to be able to take the proper actions. And we pray for those things, humbly in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Mayor. Okay, additions and adoptions of agenda. I have one addition. I'd like to put it under 8F if I could, please. And I'm just gonna describe it as tree. If we just put tree under 8F for other business, and then I'll have administration speak to that. Is there any other additions that need to be on the agenda?
Motion forward.
Call it F. What'd you say?
Jeff, do you have an addition on the agenda?
Pardon me?
Do you have an addition on the
agenda? Just 8F.
Just 8F?
Yeah.
Okay. Any other additions, Mayor?
No, I just was going to propose a motion to adopt the agenda.
Okay, we've got a motion on the floor from the Mayor to adopt the agenda as
revised.
As revised. All in favor? Carried. Okay. What is a consent agenda?
The consent agenda is with the minutes and with the communication that's been given to us, with all the information, the letters, etc. So it is that we approve the consent agenda is given in order to move the agenda a little quicker. Except if you have an item of correspondence that you feel should be discussed, then we can take it out and put it as an item of business. Otherwise, it means that we should have read the minute and read the communication and just by way of motion approve them.
And I move that the consent agenda be accepted.
Okay.
Did you add that item that I talked about? Confidential?
I'll get to that.
Councillor Bengry?
Yes.
If I might, there isn't anything in this consent agenda because I want to discuss this later in the agenda with how we want to deal with it going forward.
Mm-hmm. So we don't want to include all the correspondence and everything?
Just yet. Yeah, okay. I think we'll have some discussion on it and decide how we want to deal with it.
Yeah,
I withdraw my vote.
All right. Let's move on. Delegations. We got Tyler Anderson, and he has a draft for a bylaw number 1644, the political sign placement. Tyler, you've done some work on this, and this is concerning the upcoming federal elections. So go for it, Tyler.
Thanks. Well, hi, it's been a long time since I've been to a town council meeting. One of the things I've been working on in between my county assignments is this bylaw. And it serves a few purposes. The first, it puts regulations on when signs can be placed. So it would have to be after the calling of an official election campaign is when signs can be placed. It also regulates when signs can be removed. And in this bylaw, it would be within 2 days after the closing of the polls, which was pretty standard from what I researched. The third thing it does is it regulates what the physical characteristics of the signs can be. And these come from Alberta Transportation Guidelines. And if you look in the bylaw, these are in Section 5, where signs cannot emit any sound, video, or be illuminated in any way. They can't have any rotating parts or have any more than two sign faces. So basically, this bylaw would make it so the only signs people can place are normal-looking election signs. This bylaw also regulates where signs can be placed. So it can be placed on private property with the consent of property owners. And it would also deal with where signs can be placed on the town's public property. And we can get to that later because I'm sure there'll be some discussion on that. And it also, this bylaw, the last thing it does is it puts in fines for contravention of the bylaw, and it gives us some latitude to remove signs that are in contravention of the bylaw. So the bylaw as it's drafted, I looked through a few other municipalities in Alberta. Most of the stuff I saw was fairly standard. They all look basically the same. The only pieces that are different in this one from what I was seeing would be obviously where we're going to restrict signs on public property, if that's the direction council wishes to go. The nice thing for us is there's very little provincial or federal regulations on how we can deal with signs, so we have a lot of latitude on where signs can be placed and where they can't. As I said, the only provincial guidelines that we have to follow are with the way the signs look, which I touched on before. And under the Canada Elections Act, we're required to inform candidates when we remove signs that are in contravention of our bylaws. But other than that, we're free to put in this bylaw what we wish, for the most part. So I think the main question for council on this bylaw would be on what public property you would want election signs to be placed on, or not.
Tyler, we have a bylaw in place right now that during our municipal elections we cannot place our signage on public property, or town-owned property, right?
If I might,
on the blue of us,
one of the reasons for this is there isn't anything formal in place. It's been the position of the town to not be partisan so as to allow one municipal candidate to place something where others, or in all town property. So this is really the reason for it, is it would govern any election, and it would keep, as far as the signage on public property, try and minimize any look of the town being partisan by endorsing a candidate or not endorsing a candidate, depending on if our property was consumed with one party's signs or another. So we don't have anything formal, and that was why we really wanted to try and put something forward.
Okay.
Go ahead, Mayor.
Right now, if I understand what's written here, you could put it on a public boulevard on the front of a person's house, but yours would be to get the consent of the owner or renter of that property before you're able to put a sign on a public boulevard. Mm-hmm. And that would be just a respectful way to use a boulevard without frustrating the neighbors. Mm-hmm. So that to me seems to me a good clause that is inside there. Now I see that you have signs on public property, and at this point you are listing at least three areas. The Redford Ball Diamond, do we want sign there or don't we? And that's for discussion. The Town Square, do we, don't we? Probably not. The boulevard between First Avenue East and the service road stretching from 8th Street West to 12th Street West, I'm not so sure that I understand that one.
So the boulevard between... Yeah, in front of the Bargain Bar and Mike's Auto.
That little strip, the land. There's a grass boulevard there.
But what is the First Avenue East?
Well, it just says the boulevard is between First Avenue East.
Oh, I see.
Along the highway.
Almost that kind of the ditch almost is there.
Yeah, I'll get you. Okay. So essentially, what we need to decide is, first of all, on the three items, do we want to see signs? Yes or no? On the town square, I don't know how excited the neighbors would be.
By my, Mr. Chairman, these were just, we threw some properties on. We feel it's going to be easier to manage if we have a list of where they're allowed versus trying to exhaust every public property, yes or no, because that'll get a little bit cumbersome. So if council wants to designate two or three areas in town that are known public property, but we're okay with that, that's something. One other thing I want to mention that before we bring this for first reading is, in the definition of public property, we have town properties, town of Cardston, Cardston County, Westwind School Division, and offices and schools, provincial courthouse and the library. I don't have confirmation from the county and the provincial building that they want to be lumped in that definition.
Right.
So we need to confirm that. My assumption is they will want to be lumped in that definition, but from, for example, the school, they've asked to be included in our definition of public property. So that came up from a conversation I had with Mr. Sommerfeld about a year ago, and he asked if we had anything they could be included in. So they've recently confirmed that again. So we have a couple confirmations to receive before we bring it for readings.
Okay, so, but essentially, signs are not allowed, not permitted within a school zone. But
right.
we need to know, what is considered a school zone?
That was one of my questions.
Is that the school, exactly where the school starts and ends? Or is that just where the building is? Or is that the whole land?
Because from a traffic perspective, that whole road's considered a school zone.
Exactly.
I mean, the private properties that line the school zone there, or, that was one of the questions I had.
Driving school zones usually start several properties before the school does.
Well, that's the whole thing. If you look at the signs that say school zone, where you have to reduce your speed, is that where we're going to consider the school zone?
Or maybe just school property.
Right.
Yeah.
So I wanted to know how we define that. So is there a desire for this council to look at those properties that are listed there?
Councillor Morris.
I don't have a problem with restricting the Redford and the town square at all.
To put it on there?
I don't think we should have them there.
Oh, well, they're saying they should have them there.
I'm saying I don't like it there.
Oh, you don't like it?
That's my feeling.
Okay.
But, I mean, you guys can decide what you want. I'm only one voice, but that's my feeling. But the boulevard along the highway there, I don't see a problem with that. I mean, you go into Lethbridge and all those boulevards they have along Mammograph Drive, they allow people during election to put signs there. I don't find that offensive there, but if you had any concerns from anybody else, I think that it's a proper place to have them along that highway coming into town. I don't have a problem with that at all.
I don't think the city of Lethbridge really allows those signs along
Mammograph
Drive, but they don't take them down because they sort of turn a blind eye to
it. Well, it's kind of an exception during that election time.
Yeah.
Mayor?
If you said they're on a service road stretching 8th Street West to 12th, if there are businesses there, should we extend the same courtesy to them to make sure that they don't have on the front of their nose a sign that doesn't reflect to them?
I would say the difference there is the boulevard is actually across a road from
them. There's a road in between. Right. You've got it right.
So,
but I know that last time was an issue.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't hurt to ask them, or.
But if you're going to allow it on public property, I don't think an individual person can be. I don't think a private citizen can say, no, I don't want it there.
Yeah,
you've said,
yeah, I see.
If it's public property, you're allowed to put it there.
Yeah,
but it's the same as a homeowner, right?
Yeah.
The
that's
homeowner,
a different story.
You ask in that bylaw,
yeah. mm-hmm.
for them to be consulted.
But the difference there is that that boulevard is attached to their property. Like they join each other.
Right.
With that one, you've got a road that runs down the middle of it. It's not like it's attached to their property.
Yeah, fair enough.
That's why I don't think it matters. I think it's a big way.
Yeah, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think we're going to be talking at length about the details of the clauses when we get to 7D. And perhaps we could, you know, finish with our delegation and then excuse him so he doesn't stand there all. I do have a couple of questions for him.
Well, I'd like to move the 7D into this delegation area so that we can excuse Tyler.
Right.
He has a drive back to Lethbridge. This way he can answer the questions and then we can make recommendations to the council. However we want to.
The bylaw is implying is that we would remove the sign. Is that
a $100 fine?
There's it.
No, $100 fine in there.
Okay.
Well, there'd be a $10 fine for every contravention that the CAO or his delegate would consider deliberate.
$100
fine. Oh, and mine is 10.
$100 makes more sense.
Really?
10? I don't see a $10 one.
Yeah. $100 then.
$100. Okay, you're two. So, Tyler, you're suggesting a $100 fine?
Yeah.
In contravention?
$100.
Or $10?
About $10.
I must have an outdated draft. So
it says $100.
I think the key there is where it does say the $100, that it's when it's deemed to have been in contravention deliberately and repetitively.
Yeah.
So it's not like somebody accidentally puts it in the wrong spot. Yeah, they're not getting $100 fine.
No. Yeah, we'll phone them. And
It's once they've been phoned and told, hey, don't put it there, and they put three more there. It's
right. Yeah, exactly. Okay.
Go ahead, Dennis.
Hey, another question I've got under general provisions there, Tyler, the election signs, the size there, that 5A must not be larger than 1.5 square meters. There are signs out there that are much bigger than that. Yeah, they're 4x8 sheets, and that's a normal size. So are we saying that we're now going to try and make them smaller?
In this, we have latitude on that, on how big we want the signs
but
to be.
But I think a 4x8 is probably the max that you want to have.
In some areas.
But they don't put up tons of those, and so they're not cheap.
But every year, though, In during the provincial election, there are signs that big up.
They're not normally in town, right on the front of people's property.
There are fences around town.
Yeah, there are fences.
Yeah, there are.
I know. That's all.
Ben one on Fourth Avenue, the corner of Fourth Avenue,
or by 85th.
Yeah, they've had them down by Extra Foods there during the provincial election.
Yeah, but okay, so. You're right. I remember seeing some large sign too, but not on people's lawn.
No. Occasionally there have
been. Depends on what you mean by lawn. I can name two fences right off the top of my head up on our hill that had 4x8 signs on them.
Well, there was one on the fence.
They're on people's yards, on their fence facing outwards.
Yeah. There was one on the fence on the corner of 4th Avenue and about 6th Street, I think. A big white fence with the yard. Artistic work on it.
There's a few of them that go up every year.
But they're flat, parallel to the road.
Yeah,
sure.
So maybe that's what we need to stipulate, that they're not obstructing the view of the road.
Oh, no.
Because that becomes a fairly large sign.
But doesn't that fit into the
that's
other
already in
one there where it says can't obstruct.
All right. So
if council is fine with having 4x8 signs, it's not a big deal to change them if you guys are
comfortable with that. Mm-hmm.
I mean, so
it's
long
as expensive, you're not going to see very many of them out there.
I've probably seen two or three at most in this town.
So council, we've got this in front of us. We've discussed it. Do you want to give Tyler some recommendations to tweet this thing and bring it back to our council meeting?
We have not addressed signs on public properties.
Are we looking for a first reading today?
No.
Okay.
No.
Okay. All right.
Next week.
Yes, of course.
So
the committee.
The biggest thing that I'd like to see addressed is actually the school zone.
Yeah.
Not question. Mm-hmm. If somebody's house is along the school zone road, there does that mean that they cannot put a sign up? I would just like to see it say something to the effect of on school property included in that.
Yeah, limited to the school itself.
Yeah, you'd have a half a block, that's every side of the school that you'd have houses in, right?
Yeah.
Good point.
So that's.
So that's one that I would like to see taken out.
But essentially, we have not addressed the signs on public property. Do we want to see them there or not?
You mean on the, like, the town square and?
Redford Park and the boulevard. The boulevard seems to be that we're okay with those.
Yeah, if they're on the boulevards.
Okay, so the Diamond Ball Park around that area.
You wouldn't want them up on the town square, but on the boulevards around it.
Because the boulevard seems to be okay on that one.
Town square doesn't have boulevard, it's had monolithic sidewalk.
Doesn't it have boulevard?
No.
It's monolithic all the way around.
Yeah, it is, it's one big square.
I would agree, I don't think the town square is necessarily an appropriate place to have open signs.
I thought there were both.
I don't think so.
And in the past, we have.
We haven't, we've told people not to, yeah.
Yeah, and the Redford.
Now, they did get put up last provincial election.
Yeah.
But I think we advise them not to.
Follow them and ask them.
Yeah, Redford Park, you can put the signs along the roadway.
Yeah.
But not right in the park itself.
If they put it, yeah, if there's a boulevard or a borough.
There is no boulevard there.
There's no sidewalk.
Yeah.
It's just gravel parking lot, and then you've got that fence along there.
So would we be comfortable saying that on the boulevard, yes, on the rest, not touch it? Would you be comfortable with that, so that?
I'm okay with this, having them on boulevards.
Yeah.
I think I agree on town square and Redford Park.
Yeah, personally, I don't.
There's no boulevard.
No.
Now, the provincial building and places like that, churches.
No.
They're out of it, they don't put them on there.
How about attaching them to telephone poles?
No, you're not supposed to, it tells you you cannot.
No.
No, we haven't.
You cannot put it on any physical road with structure, including bridges, guardrail, retaining wall, fences, concrete barrier, fire hydrant, sidewalk, pathway, crosswalks, or streetlights. Well, we don't have telephone poles.
Yeah, no, that was just a clause, I copy and paste.
There's a few tell us infrastructure pieces around town.
Maybe we should add that to the list. If it's not on streetlights, shouldn't be on telephone poles either.
Or power, well, we.
Power poles or telephone or.
Councillor Bengry brought up an interesting point, how do you deal with garage sales, yard sales, stuff like that?
Well, that's.
They're all over.
Different.
Yeah, but.
And I don't have a problem with them personally.
This is election.
We're dealing with election signs.
You're just doing election signs, so we're okay with those type of things, sales and stuff like that.
So can we add power poles to the list?
Yeah.
I think Councillor Barnes, I think you brought this up, and we hadn't considered it, but was churches, church properties.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know, I guess, in my opinion, do we just default that back to, they're privately owned, they're not public spaces?
Yeah, and I don't think they want.
They have to have consent, right? We would just assume they need the consent of that church, whatever the denomination.
And I don't think that they would allow that.
No, they don't, but.
Okay.
I just don't know if we want to mention it in here, and we just put it back to its private property.
Yeah, I don't think so.
You get consent. But we haven't considered churches, yeah.
Okay. But if we write, if we put it inside there, if we put churches, then we should put in bracket, not without.
Well, I think it should be left out of there. If it's private property, I don't think we should be passing.
Say consent of the property owner.
Yeah.
So there we go.
Whether it's commercial, institutional.
So there you have.
Okay, Councillor.
We put it on.
So just curious about town-owned vacant lots, like you just happen to know that lot's vacant.
Yeah.
You think, well, can I just put it right there in front of that one? Do I need to ask the town's permission?
You should.
So what we hope within the bylaws, if we identify the one place that they can be on public property, that's the place.
Everything else is.
And every nomination office will be informed of this whenever there's an election.
Well, I'm just thinking.
But I know what you're saying, there's one on Main Street, for example, there's five or six around.
Well, historically, like right across from the high school, right up along that whole piece, there's always, all the way pretty much down the hill.
Yeah.
You know, there's always signs. And I'm not saying we should necessarily restrict them, I'm just saying maybe it's worth adding, you know, vacant lots, public-owned vacant lots.
Yeah.
Rather than send the calls this way. I mean, there's several within town that Just a little.
Councillor, are you finished with Tyler's question?
One last question. I noticed in 10, it looks like B, 10B, we've got 10A says within 1 meter of the edge of pavement, and then 10B within 3 meters of an intersection. And again, just thinking best practice, what I've seen in the past, I've almost always seen corner signs that would violate the 3 meter rule. So I would hate to just say, you know what, you're all going to get a $100 fine, versus you put them there anyway, maybe we should just say, look, people take the corners. That just makes sense. So.
The intent of that one was a concern about traffic and sight lines and stuff like that. That was a concern. I agree with you, Councillor Peavoy. Historically, you've seen them that way. And I know that they've caused wrecks.
Maybe just the little ones, right? Like we say, you know, little signs within the 3 meter. I mean, 3 meters is a lot.
3 meters outside, is it's only three strides.
3 meters.
Well, I know, but I'm just, again, I'm thinking of where I've seen signs in the past, and I've seen a lot of violations of that one, right? So I'm thinking, we're going to create a lot of
extra funding for the town.
Extra funding for the town.
Yeah, what does council think on that? We looked at it from a traffic perspective and a pedestrian perspective. That's where it's coming from, and it's consistent with other ones we saw. I would agree they're going to end up there a bit. The hope of this is that before any election, every riding office has the regulations. So anybody that's working for that nominee knows the regulation. That would be the hope.
Right.
And the fining is only for deliberate contravention of the bylaw after you've talked to them. So I would hope that would mitigate that. But what are your thoughts?
I'm thinking we got to do it pretty quick. We're in the middle of a campaign right now.
Yeah, but I mean, we've been through a lot of campaigns before, so.
Okay, somebody want to make a recommendation, please?
Unless you wanted to.
Well, we'll tweak everything we've heard tonight and bring it back to a council meeting for a reading.
I'm just curious
if anybody, any thoughts on Councillor Peavoy's comment on the 3 meters from corners, if we want to stick with that.
We'll pace it off. I agree with Councillor Peavoy there that, I mean, I don't have a problem with the small signs being there, so maybe we could put something in there to the effect of
big sign.
A sign that sticks up a foot and a half off the ground is not going to be impeding anybody's vision or causing a traffic problem. Mm-hmm. Even if it's almost right on the corner. So if we just left it at a meter, as long as it's the small signs, I don't see that would be a problem.
Yeah, we already have.
We already have the 1 meter part.
And we already.
So you would have one by 1 meter kind of.
We have one on corners. They've got so on the corners they've got to be the small signs. You can't put
one by one.
Okay, so the recommendation there.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so I guess my recommendation is to take this draft with the discussion that we've had back to your committee, Tyler, and work on that, and then maybe you want to specify that 1 meter, the sizing of the sign would have to be the smaller regular signs and no larger signs.
We don't already have anything about visibility.
Okay.
Not recommendation.
Your recommendation is there. Any other discussion? I've got a question for you.
Sure.
Council, do we want to do the same kind of a ordeal, a discussion about our municipal elections?
This is for all elections. Yeah.
Yes.
It will rescind what we've done in the past.
Okay, and so and this would be.
It would also apply to plebiscites.
Anything well. Okay. Election.
Any kind of elections.
Yeah. Right. Absolutely.
Recommendation is there.
Thank
don't
you.
Need to vote on it.
No,
just my vote.
Okay.
Thank you, Tyler.
Yeah, thank you.
Feedback.
We'll be next week. And that'll take care of the 7D, please, Council, the delegation. Okay, we have an adoption minutes of the June 2nd, 2015 CCW, and you all had a chance to review those minutes.
I reviewed them all, move that we adopt the minute.
Second.
We have a motion to adopt the minutes of June 2nd of 2015. All in favor? Carried.
Sign ones for me.
All right. Well, I'm not very good left-handed.
Come on now.
Okay.
That was 19, that was like...
Bylaw and policy, let's start with 7A. This is to rescind the policy as pertinent aspects of the policy of new bylaw 1634. If you read the cemetery rules and regulations, it's pretty vague and it's different. And so what they have is they've got a policy in place or another bylaw in place, 1634. And if you had an opportunity to read 1634, what we're going to do is just rescind the old cemetery policy. Do we want to go ahead and do that?
I want to make a comment on this.
Go ahead.
I was just reading on this, I guess it's section 2 about the real flowers as opposed to the plastic flowers. It says only real flowers will be allowed during the period of April 1st to September 30th. And I got thinking about historically here in Cardston, I don't think there know of any flowers that will survive that April time anyway. But I think probably we should change that to from April to May 1st to October, because it's less cold after that 1st of May. I know we can get snow, but I'm just thinking.
Are you talking about?
That's a pretty cold time during April. Under the regulations, that's section 2, only real flowers will be allowed during that period.
What are you looking at? Are you looking at the rules or are you looking at
Under regulations.
So under the rules and regulations?
Under rules and regulations.
The ones that they're proposing to get rid of?
C51. C51 in the top right hand.
We're going to get rid of it all together? Yes. Are we going to revamp it?
It's already been revamped. Bylaw 1634.
It is already. It's a whole new bylaw.
Yeah. Councillor Bengry, if I could.
Yes.
You've already passed the new cemetery bylaw. This was still on the books and it should have been rescinded when we passed the new bylaw.
Mm-hmm. Okay. This is the old bylaw. We need to get rid of
what it. Should have done, and this is my mistake, is this could have waited till next week because you can't rescind it tonight anyway.
No, true. We can't.
So if there's no major objection to rescinding this, I'll just bring it forward next week.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that'd be fine.
Then we'll make a recommendation to administration to bring forward this at council meeting, regular council meeting.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. The same policy 7B, the electrical rush hour policy. This does not make any kind of.
I was just wondering who was going around knocking on people's doors telling them to turn off their dishwashers.
Yeah, this is a strange one to me, and so I bring it to CCW. In case some of you might have rationale for keeping it, but I'm not sure who the policy is intending to govern.
You turn your George Ford with the
plug-in cars, people. Yeah.
I mean, who are you gonna?
Unplug it at night.
Yeah, who's gonna administer this?
Yeah, it's a bizarre one to me. So if there's no objection, I'll bring it back next week for rescinding.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That would be good.
Now, 7C came out of the George Cuff review. You remember that he wanted a policy on preparation and so forth of the budget. Our administration has done that.
Yeah.
And I'd like to have Jeff speak to that, please.
Thank you. All I'm really looking for here today is Hawkins drafted this. I think it's relatively simple. We weren't trying to draft an onerous policy for this. It's a straightforward process, but an important budget policy to have. So really, if there's any feedback before we bring it back to council for approval, we'll take that now. Happy to tweak it if you feel that there's something missing that should be addressed, or if you don't like some of the time frames in that, by all means, this is simply our chance to hash it out before we bring it back for approval.
Mayor Crowe?
I would say personally, I read it and I find it to be a good policy that really explains the process of delivering a budget on time. So I would recommend that we adopt this policy at our next council meeting.
Any other discussions? Councillor Edmonds, you're on the budget committee. Do you have any recommendations?
No, I just
Okay, Councillor Peavoy?
Yeah, the only thought I had as far as policy, and I don't know the history, so how accurate we've been able to do this over the past few years, but it seemed a little close when the second draft was discussed by the last meeting in November, and then the third draft be ready by the CCW. So it sounds like we only get a week there, or we only give administration.
Yeah, that's true.
It seemed a little tight. That was the only thing that jumped out at me as.
I'm trying to think, I wonder if Hocken was being cautious, as sometimes you only have one meeting in December too.
Right, and that's.
I'll look at that one a little bit closer, because I agree with you. If there was anything major, we had some things that impacted the budget greatly. I mean, like, for example, tomorrow, I have to start on the budget for next week, and I have 2 days to do it, right? So that could, that's a good point.
I hate to put us in violation the first year running.
Yeah, and I appreciate that. That's good. We'll look at that closely. One thing I wanted to mention too, Council, that it was an interesting process when I went, I looked back through our motions over the years of how we've adopted the December interim budgets, how we've adopted the budgets with amortization and without amortization. And I don't want it to sound, we didn't try and, what's the word here? In sections E and F of number two, we actually put the wording of the motion because we haven't been doing it consistently in the past.
Right, yeah.
And I would suggest that a couple of times it was maybe iffy if we did it correctly in the past.
Yeah.
You know, that we just weren't using the right word. And so, for example, under the Act, a council can adopt an interim budget in December, and that's usually if you failed to produce one.
Right.
So you use the one from the year previous. Well, we had many years where we adopted an interim budget, but we had a new budget, and it was intended to refer to a new budget. Right. So we've tried to just make sure that the wording, we've talked with municipal affairs to make sure that they were comfortable with the wording and that it's consistent going forward. I think that's going to be a good thing for us.
Good.
Councillor Morris?
I just want to ask you a question, Jeff. How are we doing with our budget with the new provincial government? We were talking that we didn't know whether our money was forthcoming yet.
We're okay. We don't have our MSI money yet, but we've been told it's at the ministry, or it's at Treasury, for they're going to be sending it out soon.
Councillor Morris?
We'll be fine.
Yeah.
Could we move that question into the question area?
Yeah.
Sure. Can you leave that for the question area?
Maybe the short answer is good.
Yeah.
Pardon me?
Maybe the short answer is we're good.
Yeah.
We're okay.
Yeah.
That's everything we thought we were getting, we're getting.
All right. Any other questions for our administration?
So I'll look at that timeline. Thank you, Councillor Peavoy, and we'll bring that back next meeting.
Do we want a recommendation to bring this forward?
I have a recommendation on the table.
Oh, you do?
Already did.
Yeah.
There you
go.
So maybe what we need to do is tweak it a little bit with the revision proposed.
And that's part of your recommendation?
Yeah, so that.
All in favor? Mm-hmm. Let's go for it. Okay, we're finished seven. Bylaw and policy. We'll move on to eight, with just other business. Emergency training schedule. I believe, Councillor Barnes, you were the one that brought this forward the last meeting. You didn't quite understand this emergency training.
Yeah.
And so I'm going to turn the time over to Jeff to talk to us about that. There is three different emergency training schedule dates. And so, Jeff, if you want to.
You bet. So following that meeting, I met Mark Murphy, wanted to come meet with me, and we had a little bit of money in an approved grant from last year that we didn't spend all of it. We're only talking a few $100s, but it was enough that we could buy a couple lunches for some training by the end of the year. So when I talked with Mark, I expressed council's concern about maybe not being as up to speed on council's role in emergency management as I'd like to be. And so we've come up with a bit of a schedule, killing a few birds with one stone. Mark's going to come to council next Tuesday, and he's just going to do a 15-20 minute presentation. In fact, him and I might tag team it just a little bit on some of the basics of their role as the province and how that will interact with you as a council and us administratively. On October 27th, we're looking to do a 1.5 hour training session on emergency operation of the towns, just the town of Cardston staff and you as a council. Now, your role in it is essentially declaring that state of local emergency, communication, stakeholder collaboration, those kind of things. So that'll be a lunch session. We'll start at noon on October 27th. And this is all pending that it works for people's schedules. And then on November 24th, we'll do a full tabletop. Now, this is something we do every couple of years, and we alternate between the town and the county, where we run a scenario. So we bring in the stakeholders. So in this case, I envision we'll have the town, probably myself, a couple people from the office, the county, a couple people from their office, the school, our disaster social services people, Alberta Health, and maybe some other important stakeholders there. We'll run a scenario on how that all plays out. And Mark has said that he'll run a scenario that would involve you as council as well. So if you wanted to attend that, whoever could would also understand what your role would be in that scenario, which would be probably a large wildfire, long-term power outage, something along those lines is usually the scenarios. So those are the three dates we picked. I don't need them tonight necessarily if you want to look at your calendars, but probably by next week I need to have some idea of which councillors can attend so that I can plan accordingly for training and for food.
Just a quick question on that simulation day. Do we normally also include some representatives from local churches and such on that activity?
Mark will have a bit of a feel for the scenario, so we'll see. What we have is we'll have our director of social services, and they're the ones that have those contacts with the stakes, and they liaise with the churches for resources. So we'll see. We might, yes.
So I think the churches would probably be thrilled to be involved in something like that.
Right. So whether they have a high counselor or somebody appointed to look at that, then we could certainly look at that. You bet.
Just looking at the calendar, and that's on our regular council days anyways, isn't it?
Yes. The long session in the afternoon was kind of intended to roll into your council meeting.
Yeah.
Because I know many of you try and keep those days somewhat open.
Yeah. So none of those dates are a problem for me.
Okay. How about the rest, Council?
I'm fine, perfectly, except for next week.
I'm fine with those two.
Okay.
Okay.
Sounds great. I'll plan on all of you for the two latter ones. Councillor Barfuss won't be here next week, but yeah, we'll plan on that. And I hope that gets everybody, myself included. This is my first kick at it as the Director of Emergency Management as well. So this is a process I need to go through. So I'm hoping it's good for all of us. We feel a lot better about it after the event, I hope.
Yeah.
After the training event, not the emergency event.
We don't want to be an emergency.
We never want to have to use any of those.
Jeff, if you'd like to stay right there, we'll move on to 8B. And this is the consent agendas. Now, this is an important thing, Council, that there has been questions arise from administration and probably from other councillors on consent agendas. And so I'm going to have Jeff explain what it is. It's in your packet, consent agendas, and it's interesting. It's an interesting read, and it can be very effective. So
yeah, thanks. This was one where we adopted the new agenda format, and as I got looking at this consent agenda, I came up with way more questions than answers, and I don't want us to add something to our business that simply is going to complicate the business. You know, it's intended to simplify the agenda. My fear is if we're not all on the same page of what this is going to do, we'll spend more time debating what should be on the consent agenda than we would have spent debating the items on their own, which is problematic. It completely frustrates the point. So for example, I used the format that you approved last week and have consent agenda on this agenda. But, and actually Jill asked me this afternoon, what in a committee meeting would go on a consent agenda? You don't make motions to file correspondence. There's no reports. So what would you put in a meeting like this on a consent agenda? And I think the answer is nothing.
Well, it's the minutes.
But it's one motion to approve the minutes anyway, right? That's the thing. I don't want it to be like oddly redundant that we move something to the consent agenda, one item to the consent agenda, to approve the consent agenda when it was one item that required a motion.
Okay.
So we looked at, we looked at some best practice. It can be very effective. It's more effective for councils who would, and I'll use the county as an example, because Tyler and I have talked about this and he's at their meetings. They would, for example, make a motion to file all the correspondence or to accept something for information. So they would have a piece of correspondence at which we would just say, hey, that's great, there's no action required, so we're simply not going to take action. But they would make a motion to accept it as information. So a consent agenda now looks really good compared to passing a motion to 12 pieces of correspondence. But you guys don't do that, and that's perfectly fine. That's totally fine. You're not required to file things for information. In fact, we could have a good debate about the purpose of it at all, of making those motions to file for information.
However, if Councillor Creed
come up with something and said, hey, you know, just after the discussion, what about the situation? And we've already
passed the consent agenda.
No.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, then hypothetically, there'd be no debate, in theory.
Right. But, so, Jeff, if I understand the purpose here, is that if there is a lack of consensus on one item of correspondence, for example, that item, if it needs discussion, could be taken out of the mm-hmm. consent agenda and put and be put under business, other business.
Other business, yeah.
So if we don't agree totally on all piece of correspondence, what we don't agree on can go under other business, and the rest goes under the consent agenda. That's the way I read mm-hmm. the way the policy is written at this point.
Mm-hmm. Councillor Creed?
Yeah, Jeff, I'm kind of of the opinion if it's not broke, don't fix it. And what we've been doing has worked fairly well, you know, especially with the correspondence. We kind of review it, and if there's need for discussion, we discuss it. If not, we pass over fairly quickly. The only thing that might have worked in the process that we've done things is that when we have had recommendations in the committee of the whole to recommend to council to approve, you know, particular policies or bylaws, that might be a consent agenda where we say those items that were recommended to council, you know, from the committee of the whole, could be passed as a group. And I don't know if that's proper or not.
Yeah, I think so. I would have in some things. Yes, but in other things, for example, you would make recommendations to council to approve first, you know, maybe a policy. Let's just, because we did it tonight.
Yeah.
I would want to see a motion on the books in that council meeting to approve that policy.
Yeah, it should
so
be.
For me, administratively, I want a motion that says policy C-whatever mm-hmm. approved by council. That would be much clearer for me than being shoved in a consent agenda.
So in that case, I'm not seeing much.
Where I can see it, and what I was going to ask is if council would want me to assume some things in the consent agenda, and then you can pull them out if you want. For example, next month we'll have, or we just did it, market surveillance report.
Right.
We never debated, it's just really one of those things that has to, you have to make a motion, like it has to be approved, but there's no debate on it. You know, even our projects report, a lot of our reports, well, even some of those you don't make motions. And I'd be hesitant to put our finance report in a consent agenda.
Yeah.
Because I think it's highly appropriate if you have questions about the finance report, you ask them. But I can see things like our minutes, potentially, although with the mayor, she's always scrutinizing them, but that's another story.
I'm so sorry.
No, I'm just kidding.
About our assignments to our committees.
You don't approve those by motion. See, that's where you guys are different, is you don't approve everything on your agenda by motion. Some do, and that's fine, but you guys don't. And I like that, actually. I'm not suggesting you start making a motion to file everything. So I think there's a place for it, but the other thing I see is a risk, and let me tell you what I think it is. And this may lead us to maybe removing it, but I don't want to go there yet. Let's say you have a particularly contentious, I don't want to call it a contentious issue, but you have a particular counselor that has a pet project, a burning issue, and they continually want it on the agenda. So administration, they come to administration, I want this on the agenda, let's put it on the agenda. Administration prepares it, puts it on the agenda.
And it's removed.
Councillor Peavoy says, add it to the consent agenda, we outvoted you 6-1, you never get to discuss it. We can continually bury that item in a consent agenda. That would, I don't see you good folks ever doing that. But you open yourself up for the opportunity to bury potential issues that you don't want, that four of you don't want to deal with. You could continually potentially bury them. The fix to that is your consent agenda must be unanimous.
Yeah.
Right. That's the fix.
It seems to me that the idea of consent agenda has for purpose to accelerate the speed of the meeting, where we don't pass excessive amount of time discussing correspondence. while the meat of the meeting requires more time. If I remember, I went with Alberta, no, with Southbrook, and we had a meeting at the last conference we had exactly on this item. And really, all what I suggested that should be there was the minutes and the correspondence. And Weather said, really, if there is one item of correspondence or two that need to be discussed by council, because I see it as bringing us to take actions, then those should be removed. They should not even be placed there. They should be in a business.
They can be in another business. And,
right.
And the other thought I've had is where you as a council don't move to accept correspondence, by putting correspondence in a consent agenda, you've made a motion to not discuss it. Like, that's what you would effectively do, and that's probably appropriate. You know, if you just have 12 pieces of correspondence and 11 of them are just on the consent, they do not, the chair does not allow debate on those
right.
pieces of correspondence.
But
personally, I would like to see that, because yeah. There have been a number of times where we've had a lot of correspondence that's just been, we're thanking you for this, and we spend,
right.
maybe it's only 2 or 3 minutes, but 2 or 3 minutes times 15 letters, and suddenly we're half an hour in.
45 minutes.
Thank you for sending us a check. You know,
exactly.
I mean, I would
love to see correspondence.
But Councillor, with the same token, let's say that Richard, Councillor Bengry, sits there and he says, okay, we give him a check for $300 or $500, and Councillor Bengry says, hey, I want to have a review of what happened with this $500, because I don't think that it was effectively spent.
So then
pull it off the agenda.
So then it gets pulled out individually.
Yeah. Right.
So we basically sit down at the beginning of the council meeting, and we look at the consent agenda, and everybody's reviewed all of the letters beforehand.
Right.
And we say, is there any of these letters that we specifically want to pull out to talk about? Yes, Councillor Bengry wants this one here. We pull that one out, the rest get passed by consent agenda, we don't have to deal with it.
So remember, this is going to put a lot of onus on council
to be ready
and be prepared for council meeting.
You're exactly right, but that's why we're here at the table.
I assume everybody here does that.
That's what we do.
You know what assume means.
that's part of what we ought to do.
That's right. So, I'd go a little confused, well, not confused, but concerned. Because when we, you know, the way our council works, and the way that the mayor has traditionally handled correspondence, basically reviews the subject matter of the letter, who it's from, and what it's about, and that gives a little transparency. It goes on to the camera, so that people can see what we're talking about. And I haven't seen that we've spent a lot of time on it. And I don't want to remove transparency. Well, maybe we have on some, but maybe we needed to on some. I don't know. But in my view, I haven't seen that we've spent, you know, really inordinate time on matters of like correspondence. The way that the mayor has typically handled correspondence, he says, you know, this is what it says. You know, goes on to the next one.
Maybe it's because it's at the end of the meeting when I'm about ready to shut down and leave, that an extra 2 minutes just going and reviewing what a piece of a thank you letter is, it seems like forever to me.
But Council, let's remember something. Let's remember that.
But Councillor Tweed has a good point too.
Yes, well,
let's remember something now. And I'm not saying anything against our mayor.
Oh.
But our mayor can interpretate differently than we as councillors. So if we don't read that stuff and leave it up to our mayor to decipher and decide that it's beneficial or not beneficial, then what are we doing as council members?
But see, that again, that really has nothing to do with the consent agenda.
No, nothing.
The one argument for not having them in there is that I see it as Councillor Cree pointed out, is the transparency, mm-hmm. because somebody watching this on YouTube mm-hmm. won't have those letters in front of them.
Right.
That's right.
I will concede that's an area where there's value in going through each of them.
I still don't want to have to go through each of them.
Yeah, just one of the things, there are sometimes we get a correspondence where we read it over and everything, you know, that, well, we're not interested in that, and then all of a sudden, one of the council will say, well, you know what, maybe we should take a look at that. And then all of a sudden, we've got two councillors going to that meeting that we had decided originally that it wasn't important enough to go to, and then all of a sudden, when we talk about it a little bit, then we realize, you know what, maybe we should be there. Maybe we should be represented. So I can see that, you know, we don't need to always fix something if it's not broke, just like Councillor Creed said. I personally, I like looking it over and having a quick perusal of it at council meeting. I don't want to just file it and say,
okay,
because of the fact that the people in the public that do watch the meetings are wondering, what are they talking about? You know, what's all this stuff that they filed? You know, is this something that they're just, you know, putting away secretly? And, you know, I don't want them to think that.
Councillor Peavoy?
So I, just my take on the consent agendas. I like the idea of having administration and, you know, the mayor as the second eyeballs on that. Just kind of selecting a couple of items that would be appropriate for the consent agenda. We see it recur frequently, at least once or twice a month. We have just something that could easily go on the consent agenda without any hype or problem. Mm-hmm. I also agree that there's some correspondence we might want to leave out of there. And I think that perhaps, you know, the two of them working together could say, hey, for instance, if it's from a citizen within our town, you know, about cats, and they say, you know what, we want that citizen to know they were heard. We're not going to throw that one in the consent agenda. But junk mail, you know, provincial minister letters, I'm just kidding. I didn't want to group those together, but, you know, things like that, you know, don't need decisions or whatever. I think that we leave the judgment up to the consent agenda subcommittee. They decide, you know what, all that is appropriate, and then we all have the opportunity to agree with the items that they put in that consent agenda. So, I like to say, I agree. I think there's going to be exceptions to every rule. I think that the first screening of those exceptions should take place there, and then if they miss one or two, that we as council can just pull them out real quick. I like the idea of keeping the consent agenda.
Okay. I think it means that it behooves each of us to make sure we've read each of those letters and made notes if we feel there's something, and then we say we want that pulled out because we want to talk about it.
Yeah.
Mayor, you had.
Well, I think it goes along with what Councillor Peavoy said. The idea of the consent agenda was to have a little bit of that discussion on what we feel appropriate or not. And I think we heard quite a bit of information here. There are some thank you letters that are not going to do any difference to us. But I think, as Councillor Creed says, there are some that we should maybe let the public know that we have, we are acknowledging something important here, and that should be out of the agenda. And I think that Jeff should have a little bit of leeway there too, but we need to also have an input.
And I also agree with Councillor Barnes, not 100%, because if there's some questions in a letter sent to us, then we need to discuss that. If a councillor feels that it's important to discuss it, it needs to be discussed.
Yeah. But this is the whole idea. You can pull it out and bring it as business.
That's right.
And so that gives us enough flexibility to be sufficiently transparent, but yet to also be more efficient. Mm-hmm. There is a little bit of give and take here.
An example. Okay, so we get letters oftentimes from the government that have approved a project. A project may become $100,000, right? They've approved the financing, the funding for that. That's an FYI. It goes into the consent agenda, and nobody's ever, you know, they don't talk about it, right? But it's $200,000, and then we're talking about a project that we need to fund, and then the people see this on the tube, and they're saying, where are they getting the money from? Well, you know, two meetings ago, we had that in the consent agenda, but public didn't know that we received that letter or that money. We need to let them know.
If I might point out, those letters come in usually after the project's finished.
Some of them do.
Most of them do.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Those letters come about 6 to 8 months later. So the money already has been put, the money is already in a budget. We already know that it was part of a grant, and out of that grant came that project. So when we have the budget, in fact, that is when the public knows how much the government has given us money towards infrastructure or MSI, whatever, tax gas money. And that is when that is transparent and very clearly indicated. The rest is just, we give you money and the project is completed and now we can tell you you will get the money.
But we have received funding that we didn't know we were getting too. And that is bonus money, a one-time thing that came out there.
Yeah, but right?
That's an exception.
We better be saying, yeah,
it is an exception, not a rule. Yeah. So that would be under business.
It becomes new business, right? Yeah. It's new information.
Yeah.
See, and also, if you have money received for a project, the project was completed under budget, so you got money left over, that would be pulled out, and so the information would be given on what's happening with that remaining funding.
So I liked Councillor Peavoy's explanation, because what I can see is that if you know the administration and the mayor itemize so many items that will be on the consent agenda, and then it's in our package.
You will see it.
For instance, we've got an invitation to somebody's reception at AUMA. We don't have to really talk about it.
Can't see where that is.
But if they put those on our package, and then we've all had a chance to read it, then that can become one motion. And consent agenda, and then those can be not discussed anymore. And that I think would be acceptable.
So, for example, another item that comes quite often in front of council is a request for donation. We have a donation policy. If it doesn't fit the policy, it's no sense to discuss. There's no money to be had.
Yeah. Well, I mean.
So that should be put. We know if it comes from outside, doesn't fit the policy. Unless we deem it as being an important need to
in which case
do something.
We as a councillor, as an individual councillor,
we have the right to pull it out and put it on the
I like the idea that we talked about with the consent agenda has to be unanimous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So any one councillor feels that should be pulled out, it gets pulled out.
It gets pulled out.
Yeah. And I think it's fair enough.
And then that way nobody gets buried underneath of something. No. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
In a case like you're suggesting, Mayor, then if that's an item been requested for funding and it doesn't fit within the guidelines, at that point in time, administration would take care of that, send them a letter back and notifying that it doesn't
fit, and
it doesn't have to be discussed, really.
They send them back the policy with it.
Yeah.
And so they know why we didn't, right. We can't approve it.
So, Councillor Barfuss, are you ready to make the
recommendation?
For what I cut on that, this wasn't written as a policy.
No.
This was just some best practice that we could have some discussion around.
Okay.
And there might be a couple things that will tweak your procedure a while. Not a big deal. But other than that, we'll just kind of proceed with the feedback I got here tonight and start implementing it. We'll see how it goes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
If we don't like it, we can always change it.
Okay, 8C. I'm going to turn this time over to the mayor. And this is our AUMA resolutions that she would like to on board with her council. So, Mayor, go ahead.
As you know, when we are at the AUMA, we have to vote on all of the different resolutions that are presented. So I thought maybe it would be well for us to kind of review them quickly and to try to see where we can consent together, and if there are some that are really we can't really agree upon, well then you will be well to vote your conscience. And there are a couple of them that you might have to vote that way. Okay.
Yes,
there is. The first one is the MSI from the City of Leduc, requesting that the MSI be funded beyond 2018. I think it's a good point. We cannot really argue about this one. We need to have stable funding in town and everywhere around this province. So I think this one, unless you disagree, is probably a consent on that one. The next one is from the City of Red Deer. It's a New Building Canada Fund. That is a little bit a complex issue. What they're trying to do is to have the New Build Canada Fund fund projects that are priority in municipalities rather than fund the priority as determined at the provincial level. I don't really know how they intend to do that, to tell you the truth. I don't understand the criteria that would determine one or the other. So this one, I think there is a good intent, but it's not clear enough in my mind. We will have to hear the AUMA discussion in order to really comprehend how they intend to establish a municipal priority list, because it's not clear.
Mayor, my concern about this is the bigger major centers are going to be taken advantage of as the smaller municipalities such as ourselves, it's going to leave us behind.
To tell you the truth, a New Build Canada Fund this year we got rejected on a grant
that's right.
We applied. And we're not the only one. Clarisson has also been rejected.
So and small towns.
Other small towns have been rejected on
that
fund. So there is maybe a push to try to see how it would benefit us. We need to understand that better. I'm not sure I totally get it.
In addition on that issue, I really appreciate Councillor Creed's motto that there's only one taxpayer.
Right.
And the second bullet point there, providing matching funds from the province, it's just easy to just come up with billions of dollars out of thin air.
It's exactly what I underlined too, because anyway, the third one is from the town of Black Diamond, it's the City of Brooks. That one I think we should truly support. It's a grant in place of taxes for social housing. As you know, we have been cut off at the last with the last government. This new government has not made a decision. Maybe it's time for them to look at it and to help us recoup that money. The next one is one that I would say is probably one that you might have to decide for yourself how to look at it. Is from the City of Lethbridge, is a missing and murderous Indigenous woman. Although I totally appreciate the plea of the mothers, the wife, that whole community has suffered greatly from not knowing what happened to the loved one.
I had just a quick question. I do not know
how a municipality embraces that regarding a federal issue. How does a municipality put somewhere towards a federal government? I don't know.
Well, my question was, how often does AUMA lobby up to the federal level?
I don't know. I couldn't decide on that one. I understand the purpose. I also understand that there are many different positions from different government level. So you might have to vote your conscience on that one, knowing that it is a real serious issue, there's no doubt. City of Lethbridge, decreasing the voting age to 16. There's much rationale about some that is quite interesting, some that is a little perplexing. So I don't know what your feel is.
With this one, when I first saw this and started reading through it, my first reaction was, "You've got to be kidding me."
Yeah.
To be honest, after going through all of the material,
there is some rationale.
I came out of it going, maybe that's not a bad idea. From a pure numbers perspective, from their numbers, it says that it's going to have an impact of less than 1% of the vote, so it's not going to swing a vote one way or the other, even if they did vote in the block. And all of the research shows that they don't. They tend to vote the same way we do. There's some value in getting kids involved at younger ages.
Well, if you consider Councillor Barfuss, what they're doing, if you consider right now the federal election, the campaign that's going on right now, people are really tired and they're just sitting back. If you look at the numbers, the percentages of how they're going up and down, the older population is not with this movement, with this election. And so if you get the young people involved and you got their ideas coming through, I tell you, I think you'll see your percentages increase on the party levels and so forth. These young people are pretty intelligent.
The most impressive numbers that I saw as I went through there was when they used the example of what the turnout was 40 years ago and where those people, what the turnout is for those people voting today. And they're virtually identical. I mean, the differences would probably be the number of people that died.
Exactly.
I mean, it was pretty impressive. And so getting people involved at a younger age probably has some real value for our democracy.
Yeah.
And in our education system, they are doing that. They're getting the young people involved. Mayor Kronen?
There is a point that is quite interesting. It is true that in high school, in the latter years, the young people are taught citizenship and how to do mock election, etc. They have their driver license at 16, which they seem to have to be responsible at that age. There is a very interesting study on the last referendum that was taken in Scotland regarding separation of Scotland and from England, and the young people as young as 16 were allowed to vote in that election, and it did not have that crazy feeling that we thought could have happened, which is rather interesting. So there is a level of responsibility. Maybe the 16 of today was the 18 of a long time ago.
Councillor Peavoy, comment?
Best practice historically is that your electors can also run for office. And the idea is you elect your peers. And so if you want to have a 16-year-old on your town council or in your seat, then this is definitely the right step. But there are reasons why age limits are set. And I know historically we've gone from 21 down to 18. And, you know, I just don't know if there's a political party left of liberal yet. But we might be looking at one. So anyway,
Councillor Barnes.
Anyway,
I see a little credence here, but one of the concerns I have, look at the insurance statistics, it's the 16-year-olds that are the ones that are having a lot of accidents because they're careless. You know, they're excited and it's something new for them, but they're the ones that are causing a lot of the accidents, and that's why they have a limited license when they first get that license. You know, how they can drive and who could drive with them, you know, and there's reason for that.
Well, you may have to
vote. But as they grow, they do mature. But I see a lot more credence with maybe 17 up, but the 16, I don't know. I certainly wasn't ready at 16 to vote.
Okay.
Well, I thought it might be, but I knew it wasn't.
Make one comment that, you know, what's interesting in here is that they talked about how the younger people are been declining, like when they first let the 18-year-old vote. There was quite a few that voted, and that it's just sort of declined over the years. And I'm wondering if that's going to just would happen to the more and more disillusioned with the political system, and maybe there's a different answer than just changing the voting age. I think there's something else. There's another factor in there that they need to look at rather than, you know, than just letting the younger people vote. I also worry about political parties sort of targeting that voting block, because they're sometimes easily persuaded by by salesmen.
So, Mayor, this might be a resolution where we have to vote according
to you're according to your conscience.
Yes.
I told you there were a few of those on that packet. City of Ready enhanced provincial and municipal homelessness response. Well, there is always value of looking at solving the homelessness issue. There is no doubt. What they're looking at is for UMA to carry on to be a voice regarding the need for strategies at a provincial level. It's not a bad thing. Can out of that motion, can there be action? I'm not so 100% sure. The town of Morinville coordinate approach to school site placement. That is an interesting motion. What happened there is that the municipality was left out of the loop when a site for a school was selected. And the town had to scramble in order to be able to provide all the infrastructure, etc. So what they are requiring is that the town, the municipality, be involved in the process of town site selection for school. I think it's not a bad request. The town should always be involved. The next one is a common resolution from the town of Raymond, Okotox, Pincher Creek, Staveley, Penhold, Old Town, Eggville, Fort MacLeod, villages of Delburn, town of Nanton, Clarison, Milk River, village of Rosemary, and village of Glenwood, is regarding broadband, the need for the government to start to look at establishing a committee that really will take a serious look at the need for our province to be connected, not only in special area in urban zone, but to be properly connected. There has been a lot of study done. We have, between Alberta Southwest and South Grove, the mapping has been done in the southern part of Alberta as to who and where the, has put fiber optic cable. But then there's still the issue as a provider and an exorbitant cost to town to be able to offer it to the citizens, to homeowner. So that whole issue of provider needs to be dealt with sooner or later. And at a reasonable cost. If that is a future for businesses, then we can ignore it. It has to be addressed at the government level. The town of Penhold, restoring access to Canadian Police Information Center. What you have here is a request for peace officer, one, level one. Jeff is at the level one that has the ability to do infraction to cite.
Motor violation.
Motor violation.
Number violation,
yeah.
Level one.
Yes. Level one. For those officers to be able to have access at the police database so that they could run a license plate and be able to figure out if it's a first offender or if there is any kind of warrant. And the RCMP is quite resistant, so.
The reason why they are, Mayor, I think, is because it, this system, their CP system was used improperly.
Right, and it taxed the RCMP with an awful lot of extra work.
You got to be real careful when you're using the, you know,
yes,
a system like that, because there's so much information in that system that, yes, it can, you know,
going the wrong hand could create a problem.
Right.
Yeah. So that is something. I mean, I can see both sides of the story. So we'll need to be convinced.
Councillor, if I could on that one, just so you know, that impacts us too, because.
Yes.
It's for all peace officers, so even for parking violations, unless Lloyd waits for the owner of the vehicle to come out,
he
can't issue a ticket.
Right.
Because he can't identify the owner.
So in other words, it would be useful for a peace officer,
yeah,
to have access to the database. That was my feeling. I thought it could be a good tool for,
yeah,
them, but I can see also the other issue. So we need to figure out how the RCMP can feel better about,
yeah,
it.
I wonder if
If that would be a resolution that could be amended to provide basic information, you know, without going into all of the details that, that may cause problems, like, you know, for Lloyd to be able to at least find the owner, you know, access and find the owner of a vehicle.
Just a registration ownership, yeah.
Well, that might be great for a level two guy, but in all honesty, and based on what they're saying here,
this one, the issues level is one can arrest.
A level one guy pulling somebody over to give him a ticket.
And not knowing if he's violent.
And not knowing if he's a violent guy, but an RCMP officer who's doing the same job would have access to that and know that before he steps out to the window.
And I think
that's important.
I think that's important.
Well, that person can have warrants or other things, right?
Yeah.
Right. So I think we probably should support this idea.
I would like to say support it.
But we need to also understand the ramification.
I think it'd be worth our while, maybe, in our next police meeting,
that we
talk to Sergeant Zane.
Yeah, we can do that.
And see where he sits with this, and the reasons why.
Good point. Maybe administration can make a note of that.
Like Councillor Creech just said, there could be levels that CPIC would allow out without getting really heavily involved.
Yeah. There's a couple more resolutions here. The village of Webberman? I don't really know where that village is.
It's just west of Edmonton. Yeah.
Okay. I'm not so sure that I understand what the purpose of it all is. Maybe I do, maybe I don't.
I
promoting the use of nurse practitioners within the Alberta healthcare system. So those nurses normally have at least a master or doctorate in nursing and want to be able to be accessed and to be able to make decisions in a healthcare system when treating patients. It gives me the feeling that they're almost looking at the ability as a doctor does in prescribing a treatment. So I'm not so sure.
Yeah, I think in a case like this where you've got a village, you'd look at Glenwood Hillspring as a village, Waterton Lakes, a national park, where they don't have any medical doctors right there in the case of emergency. If they had a registered nurse, could that registered nurse take over and have the ability to access and prescribe?
But it's a high,
it's a nurse practitioner.
Higher
than an RN.
Yeah. She's normally a teacher. She's normally teaches nursing, because she most likely has a master or a PhD, so she trains nurses.
Correct.
So in that sense, that's what I'm trying to say. Can a nurse that trains other nurses have the equivalent ability as a doctor?
Well, just from my experience with working with the provincial, I can't remember what the services they call it, where you call in, care services.
Oh, yeah.
It's nurses that are answering the phones there. Exactly. And it's been extremely successful. I think this has the potential to be a really good benefit.
Those are highly qualified nurses.
This is about as close to a doctor as you can get.
That's what I'm saying. This is why they're trying to...
It's not just a regular nurse.
No. It's a nurse with highly level of training.
Actually, I was just talking with a nurse here about 3 weeks ago, who is actually going to school to take more training, because at the universities the medical profession is teaching nurses, because there is a shortage of doctors, especially in remoter areas.
In the rural area.
And so they are teaching them so that they can be there as a resource for doctors that can't be there.
Yeah.
You know? And so it's a good thing, I think.
Yeah, I think so too. I think in areas where the doctors aren't available,
that might be the best chance that one has.
When you do this teleconferencing,
right,
in a medical system where the doctor doesn't have to be there,
okay,
the nurse who's a practitioner can do all the things that he would do.
That will
they can go online and visit with the doctor back and forth and come to a consensus for treatment.
But that resolution is really regarding the model of remuneration for such nurses who act as doctors, really. So there is no remuneration level set up right now. So that's what I'm trying to get. Okay, the last one is sharing of travel costs to AUMA convention. That one has me a little bit baffled, to tell you the truth, because it is not imperative that we all go to AUMA. That's a choice. And I understand why they would want to do that, but I honestly believe that when you start to create pools of money here and there, and force AUMA to administer that pool of money, and then to reimburse those who did not go, to me is burdensome. Mm-hmm. I don't know that it is the best system. It would help villages, totally would, and I totally appreciate the burden that it is on a councillor in a village to go there. But all villages don't have these issues. Some villages don't even tax their people, for that matter.
But what happens if the town of Cardston gets into a financial crunch and they've adopted this at AUMA? And so we contact AUMA and say, hey, you know, we can't afford because we have this financial crunch. And just using this for an example, you know, we need your assistance to send two of our counselors to AUMA. Now, is that going to happen? I think it will be.
I don't know. You will have to decide on your own on this one. Personally, I prefer each town to look at their budget and decide, okay, we can send two or three counselors if we cannot send the whole. And we take rotations, and we inform all, or we all have access at the AUMA site, and be able to take on all the conferences that happen there. I think we have to be careful that all that is paid by taxpayer money. Sooner or later, we have to decide, how best can we use that taxpayer money? Sure, we need information, sure, we need education. But I think we have to be careful.
But let's remember that AUMA only happens once a year. AAMD and C happens twice a year.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so you get a lot of representation at AMA, yeah. AAM and DNC.
No, I don't say that AUMA is a bad thing.
No.
Trust me, I think it's a great thing. You create great contact, you create great things. There is that excitement of being together to learn something. There is all that. But there is also wisdom as to each council has to decide how best to figure out what's coming due to them.
So, any other questions for the mayor on our resolution?
We go to AUMA, but we seldom go to the FCM.
Same story, right?
And that would be one that we'd have to look at.
Absolutely, yeah. And that's the reason why.
You know, we said that we would review all that in the fall. So that would be a good thing. Anyway, you vote the way you feel it's right. The City of Calgary, now that's an interesting one. To include auxiliary cadets in police officers' collective bargaining act. That one is to try to get the cadet to do police work in their town. And in order to do so, to include them as part of the police officers' collective bargaining union.
Does this only affect Calgary? And
well, it's and going to affect possibly Edmonton, Lethbridge, Medicine Hat, Camrose. It will not affect us because we have our CMP doing our policing. So, your take on that? All right.
Where's the liability sit?
Well, that's because once it's part of the bargaining unit with the police officers, it would be covered on the same act regarding liabilities. That's the whole idea.
It's
if you put them in the same, under the same act, then they're covered for liability.
I don't want to make a motion to have a break for 10 minutes.
I'll entertain a motion for a 10-minute recess before we get into the 8D. All in favor? Thank you.
Jill just wanted to grab some food too. That's where she is up.
No.
Maybe she should make it 15 minutes?
Should we?
I'll change that to 15 minutes.
No, but then make it a supper break.
Make it for a supper break.
Yeah.
Okay. So when is she going to be back?
As soon as she's just going over to the aunties and back.
Oh. All right, well, what do we want to do? Do we want to keep on going, or what do we
want to do? You get through maybe 8D, and then when she gets here, we recess?
I need 2 minutes anyways.
Then run.
Okay.
We're recessed now. Go.
If she doesn't get back by the time you get back, we'll reconvene for the
Council, while we're in the break, I've got a notation here that we have a Mormon trail.